Hi folks, Rob Ager here. Another top 25 list. I put this one together today while I was out at lunch. I'd been thinking about it for a few days. It's my top 25 social message movies. This one was a little bit awkward to do. I mean, I'd had a couple of tries at doing this over the past week, and I realised that the criteria of how you put the list together severely alters what the eventual list looks like. At first, I tried going with a sort of intellectual approach of which movies have had the greatest impact on society and, you know, which ones have brought important issues to social attention. So I made lists based on that, and I had something like 60-odd films listed to pick from. And then when I started picking my favourites from that list, I started to realise that, well, you know, my choices aren't necessarily based, or my first choices are not necessarily based upon which films were the best for society, but it's more or less based on which films were best for me personally. And so I thought, well, yeah, let's just scrap the intellectual approach of what was best for society in terms of social message movies, and just go with my own personal flow of, you know, which films communicated with me the most. I figure that's the most honest way to do this video. So on that basis, there are some social topics that haven't really made it into my list, probably because they're not topics that profoundly affect me, or at least they haven't in movie form anyway. For example, you're not going to find a ton of movies in this list to do with women's rights because I'm not a woman. Okay, so counting down. At number 25 on my list is a Jack Nicholson film called Five Easy Pieces, which is not very well known these days. Hardly anyone talks about this movie. I think I've only ever met about two or three people who've actually seen this film. Okay, so Five Easy Pieces is, I suppose you could call it a sort of relationship drama, a little bit of a dark one. It's a very small scale film, a small number of characters. It's not a big bombastic movie. It's just about regular everyday people. Jack Nicholson plays this character who, he has this issue where he wants what he wants in life, and he won't accept anything else. You know, you often get this with people in life. You know, this thing of where people, they've got a specific goal that they want to achieve, and they've got this vision in their heads of exactly how they want their life to be, and they won't accept anything other than a lifestyle that perfectly matches their ideal. So Five Easy Pieces is about that. You know, Jack Nicholson's got this girlfriend, and she's very cute. She doesn't blow his mind. You know, she's a nice girl, but yeah, he doesn't want her. He wants this other girl who is not available and stuff. So the film is all about that, about people who ruin their own lives by not looking at what is available to them in life and saying, well, you know, I'll make the most of what is actually available to me in terms of opportunities and so on. And people who ruin their lives because they will only accept a perfect vision of life that is largely unattainable for them. So Five Easy Pieces is one of the rare movies that I've seen that goes into that particular topic. And there's a fantastic scene in the movie which really sums up the character for me. And when I first saw the movie, I didn't really get what the scene is about. I thought it was hilarious. But Nicholson and the people he's traveling with, they go into a diner. And, you know, they're ordering food, and Nicholson is given the menu. And on the menu, he doesn't like anything that's on the menu. He wants a very specific meal. He wants certain items on the meal and certain items not to be on the plate. And he wants each item cooked exactly the way he wants it. And the waitress is arguing with him, saying, well, you know, we just do what's on the menu here. We don't do tailor-made, orders of that nature. And so after a lot of arguing about this in a quite hilarious way, Nicholson flies off the handle, kicks off, has a big argument and storms out of the place. And I thought that was fantastic summation of the character. You know, it's kind of like life. It's like there's a life menu of what's actually available to you, and then, you know, you make the most of what's on there, and he wasn't willing to do that. So yeah, Five Easy Pieces, number 25 on my list. Number 24 we have, this was one that was on my science fiction list as well, is Rollerball from, I think it was 1978, definitely a 70s movie. Rollerball is a science fiction film, at least on the surface, but underneath it all, it's all about a simple thing, the individual versus the state. the power of the individual to lead and inspire and influence other people, and how when you get a very centralized authoritarian government, it doesn't want strong individuals. So the movie is all about that. This guy is the he's the most famous sports star in this violent futuristic game called Rollerball, and he's becoming almost godlike to society. You know, people are following him and worshiping him, and you know, and the state tries to chop him down, tries to persuade him to, you know, take a bribe and just lose a game and stuff like that, and he refuses to do it, and he just keeps playing on. To the point where the state says, right, we're going to have a death match between your team and this team from Japan, I think it was, and pretty much everyone's going to die in the game. And he still goes ahead and fights the game at the end. It's just a great movie about the power of individuality versus the state. Number 24 on my list, oh, sorry, that was number 24, was Rollerball. Number 23 is Tigerland. A little bit of a crossover with Rollerball, this one. Tigerland is a sort of a war movie. It's about military training, soldiers getting ready to go off to fight in Vietnam. And the lead character is a guy who completely rebels against his superiors during the military training. You know, he's very smart and he's tough. And what I like about it is that basically the normal movie archetype of the perfect soldier as being this guy who's really, really tough and always gets the job done, and his superiors are pleased with him. They might be, you know, he might veer off the track a little bit and do things his own way, but at the end he gets a result that his superiors are actually really pleased with. Tigerland takes that stereotype and flips it on its head and makes the hero anti-authoritarian. You know, he gets the women, he's good looking, he's fast, he's sharp, he's intelligent, and yet he just keeps saying "fuck you" to the to his superiors. I just really like Tigerland for doing that. It's such an unusual take on the military soldier archetype. Number 22 on my list is Trading Places, the comedy film from, you know, the early 1980s. Eddie Murphy and what the hell was the other guy's called? Dan Aykroyd, Eddie Murphy, the two of them. Great movie. You know, it appears on virtually everybody's favourite comedies list. You know, it is a hilarious film, but the film does have good social messages as well. I mean, one thing for me when I was a kid watching it is that it introduced me to the cutthroat nature of business, stock exchanges and stuff like that, trade wars and inside information, you know, on the stock exchange. There's a whole world of activity that, you know, a lot of us don't really ever get to see in life, but that movie takes it, puts it on screen in a way that's actually entertaining and makes comedy value out of it. So that was a really impressive aspect of that movie. And the role switching thing in terms of class systems is very good in Trading Places as well. You know, you got Eddie Murphy as the down and out bum on the streets, and he's a black guy, and you got the Dan Aykroyd as the well-groomed business entrepreneur. You know, and they switch roles, and it's all done on a bet. You know, Dan Aykroyd's bosses have said, let's take this black guy off the street and let's give him a top corporate job and let's see how he gets on. And the two guys who have the bet, the older guys, you know, they have a bet. One of them says it's all about the breeding, and you know, he looks down on the peasants and the black people, anyone who's at the bottom in the poorhouse, it's because they're genetically inferior. And the other guy says, no, it's all about how they're raised. And it turns out the other guy is right. So the movie put that message across quite well, and in an entertaining comedy format. So that was number 22, Trading Places. Number 21 is another Jack Nicholson film, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. I like this one because it's there's not many films that really tackle this issue of mental health diagnosis being this really shady grey area that's open to perception. You know, doctors can, I mean, maybe it's not so bad these days, but especially when the film was made, you had these wards in the hospitals and there was electric shock treatment going on, and, you know, people were getting their brains fried with electric shock and stuff. And, you know, it's almost medieval what was going on then. And you know, all these doctors coming up with all these, you know, these diagnoses of you've got personality or disorder of blah, 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 blah. And we still get this stuff today. We get all these disorders being diagnosed by various doctors, psychiatrists and so on. And half the time, there isn't actually a real way of proving that a person has got these conditions. It's just some academically trained or academically conditioned expert looking at a person. Usually they don't have much contact with them. They just see them in the interview room and don't get to see the real life. They might look through some case notes and stuff, and they come up with these diagnoses. And I mean, I worked in that field for 17 years, and I saw a lot of people misdiagnosed in pretty severe ways. I saw people who were given the wrong drugs, given far too high dosages of the wrong drugs, and their lives were virtually ruined. And then some other doctor would come along, change the medication, and suddenly the person massively improves because the previous drug was having massive side effects on them. That whole area of mental illness diagnosis is a pretty scary aspect of society. I'm not saying that the doctors are all complete lunatics or anything like that. I mean, some of them are. But, you know, it's an issue that that film really brought to light. And I don't think I've seen any other movie that really hammers home that message as well. So the next up on the list is number 20, is another comedy, Monty Python and the Holy Grail. What? Social message movie? You're damn right. Monty Python and the Holy Grail, as well as being, like, possibly the funniest movie of all time, Monty Python and the Holy Grail is also one hell of a message about elitism and history and historical epics and how we misrepresent history through the historical epic movie. You get movies like Spartacus and the Vikings and stuff like that. You know, you get these larger than life hero characters and stuff, and the Monty Python and the Grail basically puts across the message that, you know, if you go back, a lot of these people were just frigging crazy, and half of them were murderers, you know. So you got King Arthur and his boys running around with all these crazy delusions that God has given them the right to rule over the land and so on. And in the end, they get carted off in a police van, and it turns out the film isn't even set in the past, it's set now. And these are just people with delusions about their own identity. So, you know, they get taken off, and I don't know whether they get sent to prison for murder for a historian who was killed earlier in the movie, or whether they end up getting put in a mental asylum. Either one would be appropriate. But yeah, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, it absolutely hammers the anti-elitism thing. And, you know, it really takes the mick out of the historical epic movies, to the point where even the opening credits of the movie are just done in an unbelievably silly way. You know, traditional historical epic movies would just be full of dramatic music at the start and all this kind of thing. And Monty Python and the Holy Grail doesn't even let them get away with that. Right away, it takes the piss out of the title sequences of historical epics, and the whole movie structure and everything that happens in it is just all a send-up of all that nonsense. So yeah, Monty and the Grail is fantastic. Number 19 is Kubrick's Eyes Wide Shut. Now, some of you might have thought that I put this much higher on the list, but I've put it down at number 19 for a very specific reason. Eyes Wide Shut is really, really one of the most fascinating movies ever to come out in terms of its social effects. I remember when I first saw it, my head was just blown. I was like, what the hell is this? You know, the orgy sequence with the mansion, and the rituals of the rich and powerful engaged in rituals. I saw that and I was like, what? Is this real? Stanley Kubrick just died? What the hell's going on with this? And so what that movie did is it sort of prompted a lot of people to start looking into how our society is structured, and whether the elites in our society actually engage in this kind of thing, you know, these rituals and, you know, sex parties and stuff like that. And the film does have some truthful elements in that respect. And the conclusion I came to in the end, when I did a pretty large study of the movie regarding the secret society references, is that I came to the conclusion that the The Somerton Mansion orgy that we see in the film is basically an amalgamation of multiple secret societies that have existed across the world and throughout history. It is not a literal representation of a single secret society. When you see Eyes Wide Shut, you're not seeing the Illuminati. You're not seeing the Freemasons. You're actually seeing a hybrid of multiple groups. There's elements of Freemasonry in there. There's elements of the sex magic cults that were going on in America back in the 1930s and 40s. There's elements of the Hellfire Club. Kubrick has just took all these big secret societies, which are all psychologically similar to each other anyway, and he's thrown them together in this hybrid version in Eyes Wide Shut. It took me a long time to figure out that that was what he'd done. The reason I've moved Eyes Wide Shut lower down the list is because I don't always find it the most entertaining film to watch. It's very slow and stuff, but my primary reason for moving it down the list is because a lot of people have been sent off on a crazy tangent by this movie. They think that what they see in the movie is real. The secret society is a real secret society. And they haven't figured out that it's actually a fictional one. It's just a hybrid. So a lot of people really, really got mentally trapped in thinking that what they saw in that movie was a real secret society. So that's why I've moved it down the list. I think that film may have done as much social harm as it has done social good. Right, and you all know how big a Kubrick fan I am as well. So, number 18 on my list is They Live. Another big conspiracy one here. There's not many conspiracy ones on this list, but we've got two of them sandwiched together. Number 18, They Live. John Carpenter's movie about aliens who are on Earth and they've got everybody mind controlled with all this hypnosis stuff and that. The one thing I really like about this movie is when I first saw it, when I was in my teens, a lot of other people saw it, public knowledge of propaganda techniques in the news media, it wasn't something we were all aware of back then. There was no internet. And so, our knowledge of the world basically came from our schooling systems and academia, but largely came from what we saw on TV and read in the newspapers and magazines and stuff. And then a movie like They Live comes along and basically, in a very crude manner, it shows you, look, what if all of this stuff that you're reading is just lies? What if it's manipulation? How would you know? And so, the movie, although it was done in a very silly science fiction manner, it planted that seed in people that, hey, don't let the news media control what you think. Think outside of it. Question what you read. Question what you see on TV. Great social message and done in a very entertaining manner, which connected with a lot of people. Number 17 on my list is The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. A totally different social issue on this one, animal rights. It's a horror movie. It's very, it's not very gory. It's perceived as being gory and it sort of presents itself as if it's gory, but it's not actually gory. It is a very, very brutal film though. The director, co-writer and director Toby Hooper has openly admitted that the movie was basically a big message against the meat industry and the way we treat animals and how we raise them to be slaughtered and killed to eat. Now, I'm not a vegetarian. I do eat some meat, but if ever you want to see a movie that is going to make you think twice about eating meat, Texas Chainsaw Massacre is the one. The people who are in the movie, they get slaughtered like cattle. You get cattle showing up at various points in the movie and so on. There's lots of imagery of meat on plates, like at the end of the movie, they're sat at the dining table, the girl is tied up and she's with this crazy family and all the plates have got all the sausages and beef and everything on it. It's just a really good movie to draw your attention to the horror of abattoirs, animals just being bred for slaughter and treated like dirt along the way. So yeah, good movie. Number 16 on my list is American Beauty. American Beauty, it's a bit hard to nail this one. For some reason, that movie really connects with me. I don't think there's any particular single issue that stands out in it. There are multiple social messages in it that I really like. The central one would be about people who live fake lives, trying to create an image of success and all that. I think that phrase is actually used in the movie. What was the phrase? In order to be successful, one must project an image of success at all times. Yeah, that was it. That was the line in the movie. I was like, yeah, okay, yeah, that's the dickhead philosophy right there. And the movie rallies against that and shows how fake it is and how the people who live that philosophy are actually really unhappy beneath the surface because they're in denial of reality. They're trying to persuade themselves that they are fantastic people living this wonderful, fabulous life. They're winners, and everybody else is, well, most other people are losers, but they're winners. And if they wear the right clothes and have the right amount of money and the right gadgets to show off and stuff, then somehow that equates to happiness and being a valuable person, and it doesn't. Yeah, there's a handful of other social messages in that movie I like, but I won't go into them right now. And what's next on the list is number 15 is Francis Coppola's Rumblefish, which most of you won't have seen. It's a black and white early 80s movie. It was a huge flop at the time because it's so philosophically bizarre. Fantastic cast, cinematography, technicalities of the movie are amazing. Get a HD copy, it looks fantastic. Rumblefish, I think there's a key aspect of that film that I really like. Again, like American Beauty, it's a film that's got multiple social messages. One that really stood out to me is the loneliness of people who are highly intelligent and look at the world in a different way to most other people. It's not that they're deluded, they just have a different view of life than does the average person. There is actually a little bit of dialogue in the movie about that at one point. Every now and then comes along a person who has a different view of the world, but that doesn't make you crazy. An acute perception doesn't make you crazy, but it can drive you crazy. And I thought that was a good little line in there. And you know, the film has got this character played by Mickey Rourke, and for me it's easily Mickey Rourke's best ever role. It's the most well-written role he ever played, and he's fantastic in it. And yeah, he's this like isolated guy who can't connect with other people because he's on this intellectual level and this alternate perception of the world, which other people just cannot understand. And you know, that was something that really connected with me when I think I was about 14 or 15 years old when I saw the movie. And at the time I was living in a rough neighborhood here in Liverpool, and a lot of my friends, it was all like drugs and there was a lot of fighting and stuff going on, and I got roped up in that kind of lifestyle and I didn't want to be in it. I knew it wasn't for me, but I was just doing it just to fit in. And I saw Rumblefish and I really identified with that character and how he was part of a neighborhood youth culture that was just, it was just beneath him, you know, and he was capable of more and he wanted out and he was way too intelligent for his age. And I really identified with that. That's how I felt in my teens. So yeah, Rumblefish, yeah, really had an impact on me. It made me realize that, hey, somebody else in the world understands these feelings. Right, so number 14 on my list, this is another what the fuck item, is Star Trek The Motion Picture, which was very high on my favorite sci-fi movies list as well. Star Trek The Motion Picture might not seem like a philosophical social message movie, but it had a huge impact on me. In emotional terms, the core center of the story, it's all about the Spock character. Spock is a character who has tried all his life to suppress his own emotions. You know, he's half Vulcan, half human, and he's got this ongoing battle with himself. One half of him wants to be a rational scientist and the other half wants to be an emotional human, and he's always trying to suppress the emotional human side of himself. What the first Star Trek movie does is it takes that psychological battle that's going on within Spock and plays it out on this grandiose scale with this insanely imaginative plot. And yeah, that's basically what it's all about. And by the end of the movie, Spock realizes that, hey, you know, to be completely rational and without emotional is a very, very cold, lonely and painful place to be. So it's best to embrace both sides of yourself. It was just a message that really, really connected with me. Number 13 on my list is The Big Lebowski, Coen Brothers. Hilarious movie, of course. when I first saw The Big Lebowski, I was like, what? I was half of the mindset that I thought that this is a badly scripted movie because it doesn't make a lot of sense. I kind of got the impression when it was filmed, because nobody had told me it was going to be a comedy. I thought it was supposed to be a serious drama, and I'm watching it, and I'm halfway through, and I'm thinking, this story isn't really going anywhere. All these characters are idiots. What's the point of this? And then the second time I watched it, realizing that, wow, this is actually just a satire about how stupid everybody is in life in terms of they place far too much value on things, people make too many assumptions and so on, and everyone's out chasing for the money and stuff like that, and everybody's deluded about who they are and who everyone else is. I mean, The Big Lebowski is just one big comedy send-up of how silly we all are. I guess that's the simplest way I can put it. So yeah, it's a great movie. And The Big Lebowski also, it takes the traditional movie hero of the guy who knows everything and gets the job done. And the hero of the story is someone who's the opposite to that, who is basically useless, isn't smart at all, he's lazy and so on. It's just great to see the standard lead man flipped on its head, you know. So next, number 12 is The Matrix. Matrix, when I first saw it, I quite liked it. Good action scenes, interesting plot and stuff. I didn't really get the social ramifications of The Matrix at first. And yeah, that movie was kind of like a crystal ball about the internet and how the internet itself was going to become this huge battleground of ideas. And there's plenty of stuff in the movie about the internet itself, logging in and out of the Matrix via telephones and stuff like that. And there's screenshots of news media on the internet at the beginning of the movie when Neo, the lead character, is lying there asleep. I just thought the film was a really good metaphor of internet warfare, and it's mostly psychological. There's the battleground of ideas on the internet is just fucking astoundingly crazy, and The Matrix did a good job of anticipating that and presenting it in an entertaining form. Next on the list, number 11, this one's going back a bit, is a 1960s comedy movie by Jerry Lewis called The Nutty Professor. Nutty Professor is, in a lot of ways, it's a really, really great comedy. I mean, Jerry Lewis plays a geeky professor in a university who creates a potion that can turn him into a super cool guy who's able to walk into a bar and get the women, and who's able to play piano and sing, and everybody loves him. But when the potion wears off, he goes back to being Mr. Geeky nobody at the university, who all the students just laugh at, The thing I really like about that, and the message of the movie is put across very plainly in dialogue at the end of the movie, but it's a very good message. And Jerry Lewis, as he's slowly turning back from Mr. Cool into Mr. Geek, he explains to an audience who's watching the transformation, he says, you may as well like yourself, just think of all the time that you're going to have to spend with you. And that is so important. So many people in this world dislike themselves for all kinds of reasons. And they don't really need to. They see all these magazines of people being cool and movies with people, oh, everybody's, you have to be good looking like this, you have to wear these kinds of clothes and stuff, and it's all fucking crap. It's just stupid. You might as well like yourself. Recognize the good things that are in you, and if there's parts of you that are imperfect, accept them and just go with it. And if people point and go, ha, just go, yeah, so what? And it steals their thunder away. Yeah, no, Nutty Professor, basic movie, basic message, but such an important one. Next on the list, at number 10, we have Clint Eastwood's High Plains Drifter, one of the greatest westerns ever made, definitely. High Plains Drifter is about a town of people who they all act like nicey nice neighbors, but they've got a dark history. There's a lot of corruption in the town, and all of the people in the town have covered up a murder that was done in order to protect everybody's financial interests. And Clint Eastwood shows up in the town as a ghostly outsider, a stranger. You know, in the old spaghetti westerns, he used to play the stranger who wanders into town. Well, High Plains Drifter takes that character and gives it a new twist. He comes into town and he's basically a ghost character. He's a cowboy and he's a ghost. When I say ghost, I don't mean like, you know, he's transparent and he floats through walls and shit like that. No, I'm not talking about that stuff. At no point is he ever visually shown as being literally a ghost. He can physically interact with people and stuff, but he represents the guilt, the avenging conscience. I did a film analysis of High Plains Drifter, and that's what I called it, was the avenging conscience. He basically comes into town and reminds people of everything that they've done in the past, and he starts treating everybody like dirt and ruins the town, but the town brought it on themselves. Everything that he does to the people in the town, they deserve. It's a great movie all about guilt and taking a stand against corruption and how your conscience will haunt you forever if you engage in corruption and backstab other people and stuff like that. It's a great movie. There's a little bit of controversy around it because Eastwood's character is so brutal to these people in this town, and a lot of people really couldn't stomach that side of the character, but I think it was a fantastic twist on the spaghetti western stranger wanders into town character. So that was number 10. Number 9 is Mad Max 2 The Road Warrior. What? Social message movie? Yes, you're damn right. More than any other movie that I've ever seen in my life, The Road Warrior shows a vision of society, how of what we would all turn into if the general structures of our society collapsed. You know, if suddenly we didn't have police, we didn't have a government, we didn't have a monetary system, we didn't have industry. If all of that disappeared and suddenly we were all just out to fight on our own, this movie shows how quickly we would all regress back to being, you know, basically like absolute savages, you know, caveman mentality. Road Warrior is an extremely brutal film. And, you know, I like it for that reason, because it shows that that dark side is always there within us, even though we, you know, we live in a society that has all these constraints that stop us from falling back into being these savage brutes. Well, it doesn't always stop us, but for most of us it does. So that's why I like The Road Warrior. Number 8 on my list is Taxi Driver, the old Scorsese-De Niro collaboration from the 1970s. Taxi Driver is a bit of a funny one. I think I remember hearing from Scorsese that during the production of the film, they thought that they were making a movie that was all about the downside of suburban life, city life, you know, the sort of downbeaten parts of major cities where things go on that aren't normally shown on film. So you get all the prostitution and muggings and stuff shown, and a Taxi Driver, and people who are just fallen to pieces because they live in poverty, they've got no education and so on. The movie was supposed to be about all of that kind of thing, an exposure of the dark side of our cities that don't normally make it onto film. And the lead character was sort of making his way through that and was frustrated with the world that he saw around him. But as they got into making the movie, they realized that what they were making was more about the character himself and how his extremely cynical view of society and his victim mentality, he brings it on himself. He creates his own unhappiness through his own social ineptness, his own refusal to look at his own faults, and he projects and sees the world as being at fault when it's actually him who's got a lot of faults. You know, it does both. It shows the flaws of this character, and it shows the downbeaten side of poverty-stricken neighborhoods within large cities. So yeah, Taxi Driver is great. Number 7 on my list is Good Will Hunting. The thing I really liked about this movie, and I'm not sure that it was supposed to be the main point of the movie, but for me it really stood out, was the pretentiousness of academic thinking versus self-education. This was an issue that I'd already been aware of for a long time. I mean, I didn't grow up in a background that really facilitated me going to university and getting a proper education. It wasn't really there. You know, I grew up in rough neighborhoods. And so I immediately identified with this character's position in the movie Good Will Hunting. It was Matt Damon playing the role. He's grown up in this environment. Again, it's similar, you know, similar themes to Rumblefish we were talking about earlier. He's grown up in this environment that is not nurturing, but he self-educates. You know, he reads tons and tons of books. And in this case, he's a maths genius. I'm not a maths genius. But that whole idea of self-education is presented very strongly in the movie. And there's a standout scene in that where Matt Damon's character, the non-academic intellectual, gets into an argument in a bar with a guy who's an academic, and he's one of the pretentious academics. By the way, I don't believe all academics are pretentious. Some of my favourite people who've taught me a lot through their books and their articles have been academics. You know, I don't have a total disrespect for it. But there are a lot of pretentious people in it as well. I've met plenty of them. And, well, yeah, there's a good scene in Good Will Hunting where... you know, the two of them, they get into this debate in a bar, and Matt Damon's character says to him, "You dropped 150 grand on an education you could have got for $1.50 in late charges at your public library." And I was like, what a good summation there. And it's true. I mean, almost anything that you can learn in academia, you can go out to a library, you can... I mean, even today, you can just go on the internet and find out tons and tons of stuff that people are paying huge amounts of money to learn in academia. That's not to say that academia doesn't have its values. It certainly does have some values. But yeah, I mean, a person can get a very good, broad education or can become extremely knowledgeable in specific areas without even going to university, just through reading the right books and, you know, going out and practicing what they learn in those books. So Good Will Hunting was one of the few movies that I've ever seen that pushes the self-education message strongly. Okay, folks, time for a commercial break here. For those of you who are not aware, over at my website, which is collativelearning.com, I've got a ton of videos and articles and audio files on film analysis and psychology and so on, which are available for digital download. And these are items that are mostly not available for free on YouTube or any other platform. You have to order the items one by one according to which ones you want to watch. And the items which are available to order are available on the film analysis page and here, which is the insight page. And that page, I'll just take you quickly to that. That page contains videos and articles and some audio files on psychology. There's a ton of psychology stuff there. There's stuff on video games. There's a couple of items on art, such as the H.R. Giger artwork. There's a huge study of his work on there. So say you wanted to make some orders and you were interested in the H.R. Giger one, you click view product and you have a little read up, you check out the price, and if you like it, you say I want this, and the item jumps up in there into the corner, and you can stack items up there in the corner. Let's say you went back to my previous page and you went to the film analysis page, and say you wanted The Abyss. You click I want this, and you can see that the items are stacking up there in the corner. So let me just take you through some of the other things we got. I've got a big video on the movie AI, Artificial Intelligence, which, as most of you will know, is a Kubrick and Spielberg collaboration, massively underrated film. So I've got a 147-page analysis of that film in PDF form, but it's got a whole bunch of supporting videos with it. I've got lots of stuff on the Alien films, militarism in the movies of Jim Cameron, 2-hour video, stuff on The Exorcist, a 2-hour video on Eyes Wide Shut called The Cult of Eyes Wide Shut, and in that one I explore all of the various conspiracy interpretations of Eyes Wide Shut, and I assess which ones have got merit and which haven't, and give you my final conclusions on that. Let's see, is Full Metal Jacket, you know, tons of Kubrick stuff here, a huge study on Mad Max 2, The Road Warrior, Nightmare on Elm Street, 2.5-hour analysis. Predator, 2-hour, 20-minute analysis. Stuff on Pulp Fiction, RoboCop, Risky Business, Saving Private Ryan, Scarface. Lots of stuff on The Shining, Silence of the Lambs, Starship Troopers.
tons of stuff here for you to sink your teeth into. So if you're ever bored with waiting around for me to post new content, because sometimes it takes me a few weeks between projects, then just head over to the site and place a few orders. And once you've picked the items that you want, and they've stacked up in the corner there, you click pay, and you can select to use your credit card or PayPal. It's all secure. I've been using this selling system for many years now, and there's never been a problem with people's personal data being breached or anything like that. And if there's ever a difficulty with the order, you can contact me very easily. There's a short video explaining how to place the orders and a little bit of a write-up here about it as well. Okay, so if you're interested in that stuff, then head over to my website, which is collativelearning.com. And now back to the video.
Number six on my list is Risky Business, my favorite Tom Cruise film. Risky Business, I was a bit funny about putting that one on this list, but I was thinking about it. I was like, no, Risky Business, I've always felt a very strong philosophical connection with that movie. You know, even when I saw it when I was a kid and still today, I think I did like a 2-hour and 10-minute analysis on it a few months back. And what is it about Risky Business that I really like? Well, I suppose it's in the title, really. We all have to live with anxieties and worries in life. And you can let those anxieties and worries control you and stop you from doing things. And you can let it make your life hell, or you can just get the hell out there and just do stuff. And if things go wrong, just deal with it and move on and do something else. You know, if you sit back and you just spend all your life worrying what people will think, whether you're going to not have any money and so on, you won't live a very happy life. You know, just go out and take risks. You're not going to achieve much if you don't take risks. And the movie gets that message across really, really well. So many people in society worry about so much. They worry constantly about money, about image, and so on. You know, Risky Business is a big rally call against that. Number five on my list is easily the darkest movie on the list is Snowtown, little Australian movie from 2012, which I found extremely powerful, both in the way it's made and in terms of its social message. I suppose there are two messages in this film that really hit me hard. One is the depths of cruelty and depravity that human beings are capable of sinking to. You know, it's based on a real case, and if you go and read up on the original case, it is absolutely horrific, the stuff of nightmares. The movie is about a bunch of people in Australia in a small poverty-stricken town who they team up and they decide to go out and kill paedophiles that live in their own community. And of course the ringleader is basically a psychopath who brainwashes the others into helping them to not just kill paedophiles or suspected paedophiles, but to torture them in the most horrendous ways. You read the case, and believe me, these people engaged in forms of torture that most people couldn't even consciously imagine. It's an unbelievable case. So it, you know, it shows this unbelievably dark side of human nature. But more important than that for me is the message that the movie puts across is how dangerous it can be when people get caught up in a social justice cause, which they are so convinced of, they are got so much conviction in this social cause that they're actually willing to kill and torture people in order to pursue their social cause. And that's when you know when you've gone down the wrong path, you know, when you're kidnapping people and chaining them up in a bath and then, you know, torturing them with all kinds of instruments and stuff for a social cause. That's when you know your social cause has really gone wrong. And so that movie really gets that message across. I think anybody could watch that movie and then sort of say to themselves, well, I think I'd better be very careful who I let persuade me to follow a social cause. So Snowtown is really good. Number four on my list is Kubrick's Dr. Strangelove. I think Kubrick's had, what else did he have on this list? Eyes Wide Shut was on there, and yeah, now Dr. Strangelove at number four. Dr. Strangelove is, intellectually, I would say it's possibly the most, the best social message movie ever made, because the amount of research that Kubrick and his colleagues did in order to put this movie together, which was all about the pathology of nuclear war, and you know, the mindsets of the people who were in the positions to push the buttons and cause nuclear conflict between America and Russia. It's amazing. It's so weird. You can watch Doctor Strangelove, and what happens in that movie is so crazy that you think, oh no, this can't be real. But when you actually go and read up on the sources that Kubrick was relying on, you find out that these people who were running the show in terms of war strategy on both sides of the Atlantic, they weren't, not only were they as crazy as the people in the movie, they were even more crazy. I was reading some of their stuff, and there was things that they were proposing in some of their policy documents that were even crazier than what you get in the movie Doctor Strangelove. They were talking about creating bombs that could split the moon in half. They were talking about continent buster bombs. You know, you could nuke Australia with a massive bomb that would just annihilate the whole frigging continent. You know, these people were nuts. And Strangelove, I think that movie did humanity a favour by taking these insane people and putting them on screen and showing both us and those people how crazy they were. Strangelove is great. So that was number four on my list. Number three is the critics love this one, but audiences, a lot of people haven't seen this movie, is an Anthony Hopkins movie called Remains of the Day. This was a 1990s movie, I believe, and Hopkins plays a butler in wartime Britain, and he's a butler in the service of a man who is heavily involved in politics. His boss is involved with negotiations with the Nazis to try and get them to chill out and stuff like that in the lead up to the war. And so Anthony Hopkins' character, he's caught up in the middle of this big political bizarre situation, and he actually has opportunities in the film to influence his employer with regards to his relationship with the Nazis. And at the same time, there's a woman who comes to work there. She's like the head maid, or whatever you want to call it. It's like a female version of a head butler. And the two of them sort of fall in love with each other, but Anthony Hopkins' character is so emotionally and intellectually restricted by his butler role that he will not engage in a romantic relationship with this girl. She's crying her eyes out, and she loves him. She's waiting for him to just grab her and kiss her, and he won't do it. And I think the movie's like 2.5 hours long, and throughout the whole movie you're just hoping, please step out of your butler role, quit the job, tell your boss to tell those Nazi guys to fuck off, and get the girl and kiss her and tell her you want to marry her, and he doesn't do any of it. And you get to the end of the movie and he's missed out on all these opportunities. Remains of the Day is incredibly powerful. It's really sad. You know, you get to the end and my God, you feel down. And it, for me, it's a movie that makes you think, right, I am not going to be like that. I'm going to grab the opportunities that life gives me. I'm not going to sit back and just let some predefined role, a job or whatever it is, being a butler or whatever, I'm not going to let some stupid role control me and restrict me so that I just become a cog in a machine. I'm going to go out and live. And the movie is really good at bringing up that feeling in you. So yeah, that was number three on my list. Number two, maybe the most unexpected movie on this list really, is the very first Superman film. I've been watching Superman lately. I hadn't seen it for like 15 years or so, and then I watched it a couple of weeks back and I was like, wow, this movie is so smart on so many levels. I don't even like superhero movies generally. But the first Superman film is incredibly clever for all kinds of reasons. I'm not going to go heavily into it in this little talk because I want to do a film study of Superman. But the one thing I will say, that what makes him Superman, it's not the physical powers. What makes him Superman in terms of his appeals is his values. You know, he's got really good humanitarian values. He doesn't lie. You know, he doesn't do anything bad to anybody. He puts himself in the service of humanity. And those values in him are just put across so well in the movie. Sure, he's got this stupid looking brightly coloured cape and he's flying around in the sky and stuff, but I do think the personal values of the character are what makes him appeal. And especially, I think Superman was either the first or second movie that I saw on the cinema when I was a kid, and I must have been about 5 or 6 years old. And I remember it really hitting me hard. The personal values message of the character was so good and conveyed so strongly that even as a 5, 6 year old kid, I was able to absorb that message. And I think the movie was a big hit on that level. Both adults and young kids and everyone in between could relate to the goodness of the character. And this is one of the things I don't like about a lot of other superheroes, is a lot of superheroes are basically posers. They go around with this attitude of, oh, I'm going to have a grimace on my face. It's like, hold on, you're supposed to be the good guy. Why are you pulling this gruff grimace face like you're a bad guy? Why are you trying to sound like Clint Eastwood? You know, why are you being so miserable? Superman is a happy, cheerful guy who goes out and fights against corruption and fights to make the world a better place. And he's not looking for other people to, so, you know, he's not trying to make other people respect him. He's not trying to present himself like a catwalk model or anything like that. He's just a decent guy doing the right thing. I love the way the film sticks to that all the way through. And number one on my list is, I bet none of you saw this coming, It's a Wonderful Life, the old Jimmy Stewart film. It was Jimmy Stewart, wasn't it? Yeah, I'm sure it was. Black and white movie. I can't even remember what year it was made. I've seen this movie only twice, and each time I watched it, it had a very powerful impact on me. You know, Jimmy Stewart basically plays this sort of businessman character who's in a small town in America, and you know, he's a real community guy. He's got some money of his own, and he helps people, and you know, he employs people and so on. I think he runs a small bank or something that lends money out and so on. And the whole community pretty much rely on him. You know, if somebody can't pay the debts because they're in the poorhouse, you know, he's got patience with them, and he'll try and stretch his own business interests to accommodate other people having trouble with the debts and stuff. And, you know, he basically holds most of the town together. He's a really decent guy. But there's another guy in town who's this real business shark dude who's got all the real power and money behind the scenes. And this guy basically sort of destroys Jimmy Stewart. He wants Jimmy Stewart to take over the town with him and fleece the town for everything that they've got, basically. And Jimmy Stewart, his character, doesn't want to do that. And so basically, Stewart's character, if I remember rightly, at one point he's actually thinking about committing suicide because there's so much debt built up and so on, and this big business shark guy has got him in a position where he's in severe debt and he's about to be put in the poorhouse unless he betrays the community, and he's going to kill himself. And then he gets visited by various ghosts, a bit like A Christmas Carol, you know, Ebenezer Scrooge. He gets visited by ghosts, from what I remember, and they show him elements of the past, they show him elements of the future and so on. I can't remember exactly how the movie ends, but I just remember it was a really powerful movie in terms of its messages about social responsibility and how a person who's got money and has got influence can actually do a hell of a lot of good for other people, and how other people depend on the person who's in a position of power, and how, you know, they have to make the most of that responsibility. And also, you know, a message about when everything's looking really down, you know, the tax man's after you, or the you're in severe debt or anything like that. You know, people worry so much about money in life. Don't let it drive you to despair, because at the end of the day, there's always various ways of bouncing back. And even if you do end up a little bit more poor, so what, big deal? You can always build back up again. It's a great movie. It's a Wonderful Life. It conveys its message with gusto. Okay, so that's my top 25 social message movies of all time. I didn't spend a lot of time writing this list. I just sort of threw this one together based upon, you know, my own movies that have had a strong influence on me intellectually, emotionally, philosophically. I did have about 60 movies listed, and the other ones are worth talking about. So if you want me to do a follow-up video to this one, talking about, you know, say 25 other movies that have great social messages, then, you know, just leave a like and leave a comment saying, yes, you know, give us part two. Okay, so that's it from me. You've been listening to Rob Ager of CarlitosLearning.com. That's it. Bye for now, folks.